Welcome to the ultimate whistleblowers video, where we blow the whistle on existence itself. Last couple days I've been busy because busy preparing for an earthquake. I've been tipped off that there's going to be an earthquake on the Hayward Fault, East Bay of San Francisco Bay. It's going to pop very soon, so I've been getting earthquake supplies together, and we have a couple more days to work on that. But we did a lot of shopping yesterday of food and just getting ready. I think it's going to be a 7.1 and probably a pretty good shaker. Hopefully not too bad, but it pops about every 140 years on the average. So it's pretty regular type of fault, and it's 146 years since it's last popped. And you know, we've been fortunate here that we haven't had the big one yet, that it hasn't popped yet in the Bay Area. But from what I've been tipped off in numerous ways, not just one way, but in numerous different angles, which is what I try to do. If I get it, I got a dream of this quake. I was able to locate it in the dream. I've been able to locate it in time pretty well. So, but I've gotten a lot of different corroboration from different angles on this. So I said, you know, it's probably likely. I'm not the only one who feels this way also, that the quake is coming to the Bay Area. So, okay, got that out of the way. Now, what's more important than that? What we have to say here in this video. I've been able to work through some of the most heavily resistant areas imaginable. And so I'm able to share them with the world. It's one thing to see it for yourself. It's another thing to be able to put it into words. And that's another thing to be able to actually put it out there in the world, because the resistance to this is, you know, cosmic resistance, actually. The resistance is just unbelievably hardened. Unbelievably hardened resistance to truth here in this world. The life we think we have here is not life. It's an attempt to cause life to fail. It's an attempt to cause life to fail. What is life? What is our life? Freedom. Freedom. Absolute, pure freedom of spirit. Moment by moment freedom. No moments bound to any other moments. That is what we are. That is our identity. That is reality. That's God's identity. Freedom. God creates freedom to experience whatever it is that we choose to experience. Absolute, pure, total freedom. Without any other. And what we are is spirit. In our freedom, we want to be prime creator. We want to be the ones creating freedom, creating happiness. What is freedom? Happiness. That's intrinsic, uncaused happiness. The freedom is our happiness, and happiness is our freedom. So we as spirit, we said, you know what? Let's see if we can be a new prime creator. Let's create differently than God. Let us be the ones that create our own happiness independent of reality. So let's create separately. Now, how do we become a new prime creator? Well, what we're trying to do is we're trying to show that we are greater than God. And by changing reality, by saying that we're not free. We are not free. And how come we're not free? Because we willed it. You see, we're trying to say our will is greater than God. And so that we can will unfreedom, boundness, that we have the capacity to will that. And then we say, look, our will is greater than God's. We've been able to change reality. And then, so we are trying to get freedom to fail. We're trying to use our will to bind ourselves, to say we're not free. And this would be a failure of life, because life is free. So this whole world and bodies and everything that's happening here is actually our own dream, are actually using our will to dream the scenario that we're not free. Okay, but here's the kicker, a lot of kickers in this story. We still are free, okay? We still are free. We haven't been able, we cannot change the fact that we're free. So, if we're still free, how are we continuing to pursue this belief that we're not free? And this is where it gets very interesting. And I highly advise tuning into this if you can, and seeing if we can get this cat out of the bag. And I've done it before, but this will be a little stronger, a little clearer, actually. What we do is we have this world, and we have bodies, and we have things that, circumstances, experience that are toxic to the body, that we don't, the body doesn't like, that's harmful to the body. Now, bodies being just forms, aggregates, they can be dissolved, form, dissolved, like all appearances. And if we call the body life, which it isn't, we can say that things that harm life, cause life to die, we think that those are failures of life. So what we do is we try to bring about failure of the body. The body's designed to fail, actually. But what I have discovered is, if I can put this into words properly, what we do is we target failure. We target failure of the body, what we define as failure, something that we say, oh, that's the last thing in the world I want. I don't want that. That would just dispirit me so bad. Okay, what are we targeting? We are targeting situations in existence whereby if we were to put ourselves in such a situation, we would insist that we did not choose this. We did not choose this. There's no way in the world we would have chosen this situation. Okay. Thereby proving that we're not free. Okay. Thereby proving that we're not free, which is what? Proving that our will has been able to triumph over God's will. You see? And therefore, we're greater than God. Now, if we're putting ourselves in situations that we feel there's no way we would choose this because it's so terrible, it's the opposite of what we want, which would prove we couldn't possibly choose this, then how can we be happy if we say, okay, we must be greater than God? Well, if we are the new prime creator, we say all we have to do is simply decree, will that we're happy, and instantly we'll be happy. So we say, well, it doesn't matter that we're so unhappy with this situation we're in. We'll just decree happiness right now, and we'll be happy. So we're not thinking about happiness in terms of being happy with experiencing what we want to experience. We say, no, that's not important. First we establish failure, and then that means we're greater than God, and then we'll just will that we're happy. Okay. Now, how do we get ourselves into situations that we, the opposite of what we want? And I'm an expert in knowing this and doing this and knowing it and having discovered, how did I do it? How did this take place? How did I get into a situation that was so terrible for me? I'm in a terrible situation, actually. I have been most of my life, but it gets worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. But I know how I did it. I know how we're able to do this. Let's say, for example, I'm going to explain this by using an example. Let's say there's a couple that want to get married. And let's say one of the, make it simpler, say one of the couple is the opposite of what you want to marry. Ugly, very ugly, sick, decrepit, but you feel that in getting married to them, you will succeed at failure. You will be able to say, this is the last thing that I could possibly want, therefore I couldn't have chosen it, therefore I'm not free, therefore my will has been able to nullify the freedom of God, God's will. So as you go towards this marriage, you have a marriage arranger, actually. Actually, we go to this marriage arranger. Let's say there's this lady, our marriage arranger, who's very adept at arranging these circumstances. Okay, we'll call it a marriage, just for example. Where you get married to failure. Okay, you need to, the idea is, in order to succeed, we have to be married to failure. We have to be married to a situation that we feel there's no way we chose this, therefore we're not free, therefore our will is greater than God's, we're able to overcome freedom. We need an arranger to arrange this marriage with failure. Now, as we get close to this marriage, what happens is we start getting cold feet. We start saying, whoa, wait a minute. I mean, this is horrible what I'm getting into. This is going to be disastrous for me. And we say, I don't want that, I don't want that. Well, we have this marriage arranger, okay, who is arranging our marriage with failure. Now, this marriage arranger is all important for our whole scheme, our entire plan to be greater than God, to limit our freedom, to prove that we're not free because we couldn't have chosen the situation. If we were free, we would never choose this, we say. So this marriage arranger is all important to us. Why? Why? Here we get into the heart of our self-deception here. Okay. So I hope you're still with this video here. Let's say we're going to embrace this failure, the failure we're going to marry. And we're getting ready to embrace this failure. And we look and we say, oh my God, I can't do it. This is the opposite of what I want. This is horrible. I don't want this at all. I feel extremely frightened and nervous and you get cold feet and you start ready to back out. Now, here is the ultimate kicker of the entire situation. The marriage arranger, okay, the one that is arranging our marriage with failure, is like a bride's, what do you call it, the bridesmaid, or something like that in a marriage, who is advising those who are getting married, and they know that we're going to get cold feet, this marriage arranger. Now, this marriage arranger is the key element in our whole self-deception, and what we have done is we have imagined this marriage arranger to be all things wonderful, all things beautiful, all things attractive. We've put all our belief that this marriage arranger is the most wonderful, beautiful, attractive, desirable experience possible for us. Okay? And so what the marriage arranger does, the fixer who fixes our marriage with failure, is this marriage arranger says, look, just imagine that you're marrying me and not marrying this terrible failure. Okay, I want you to imagine that you're going to be embracing me, this wonderfully beautiful, you know, fresh, attractive, you know, all things wonderful. You'll be embracing me and not this terrible failure. Just imagine in your mind that this is what you'll be doing. And so as you go to embrace this hideous death, okay, that this failure that you believe will cause you to be able to ultimately succeed and supplant God as the prime creator, but it's just a necessary ordeal you go through to prove that you couldn't have chosen this. Instead of seeing what you're embracing, you're imagining you're embracing this beautiful, beautiful image. Okay, and then you embrace this death, and then you get used to it. And you say, "Oh, wow, this is hideous. This is horrible. No way could I have chosen this." And you've gotten what you wanted, right? You've gotten what you wanted, which is this horrible experience you don't want. This is how it works. This is how it works. I've been investigating this entire situation of existence, and I found out how it works. We deceive ourselves by imagining we're really embracing this, like this God or goddess, this all desirableness. In our imagination, we think, "Oh, this is what I am." We consciously deceive ourselves. It's like if you're eating something, some rotten, slimy, horrible something to eat that you would never eat. You know, it's the last thing in the world you would ever eat. And you say, well, just imagine that this is some chocolate truffle or some wonderful chocolate delicacy. Oh, it's designed so beautiful. Those perfect swirls and colors. And it's just this Belgian chocolate, this wonderfully tasty confection. And just imagine that that's what you're eating. You see what I'm saying here? And then you eat this stuff, and it's terrible. Now you got a sick stomach, it's rotting your insides, you're feeling terrible, heartburn, indigestion. You know, you still feel so terrible. There's this poisonous substance you just ate. And then you say, God, God, I know. You would say, God, I know that there was no way I could have chosen to eat this. No way, it's impossible. Therefore, this proves I'm not free, that this was done to me, that the world did this to me, something did this to me. I did not choose to do this, God, because there's no way I would have chosen to eat this rotten, fungus, mildewy rottenness that makes me so sick. Impossible, you say. Therefore, I'm not free. I've proven I'm not free. The circumstances are forcing things upon me. And since I'm not free, that means my will has been able to nullify freedom, change freedom. And therefore, my will is greater than your will, God, because freedom is what you will. My will is not lack of freedom. I've proven I have a lack of freedom. I'm greater than you, God. And now, since I've proven I'm greater than you, I am the new prime creator. And as new prime creator, I decree that I'm happy. This is how it is. This is how it is. This is how it is here. This is what we're working on. And this ability to make believe that we are embracing something wonderful, when in fact we're actually embracing something very toxic to the body, toxic to how we feel, imprisoning ourselves, as it were, with something we don't want. That is the self-deception, that we imagine that we're having something that's wonderful when it's not. So this marriage arranger, this fixer, this marriage with failure fixer, who's able to rehearse us and tell us how wonderful it is that we're, what it is we're embracing, is central and key to the whole self-deception, our whole, and call it the ego. And the ego is telling us, oh, you're not failing, no, everything's great. It's the one that's telling us that everything's great, everything's good, as we wander into this desert of failure. Things get worse and worse and worse, and the ego's saying, no, everything's great, you're succeeding, everything's wonderful. Because again, we believe that succeeding at failure is success. We believe that succeeding at failure is success, and that we just need the ego, just keeps us going, even though we just can't stand it. Keeps us going, keeps us motivated to keep going. The ego says, as soon as you reach a point where you can say with certainty that there's no way you could have chosen this for yourself, then that will automatically, the ego says, overcome the will of God, and you will be the prime creator, and then you can will your happiness just that same instant. So you see how this works, and you understand now why you go through what you go through, and how you can stay motivated even when you're going down, you know, into hell, into worse and worse and worse darkness for yourself. The ego will be telling you, you're almost there, you're almost there, you're almost there, you're almost there. And will hold up an image in front of you that you think you're going to embrace this. It's like you're walking down into the pit of hell, into the most nasty, horrible circumstances. And in front of you, you have this image of this beautiful image, whatever it is, a god or goddess. All wonderful, all beguiling, all beautiful. You think, oh, I'm almost there. And the image keeps moving as you keep walking. It's just always just out of reach, like a pot, like the end of the rainbow. And you think that you're going to get that. All the while, your steps are taking you deeper and deeper and deeper into misery, suffering, and darkness. And the ego is saying, you're almost there, you're almost there, you're almost there. And you say, well, God, this is horrible. You know, what's going on? And the ego says, no, you're almost succeeding. Look what you're going to get. And again, the ego wants to bring us to a point. We're trying to bring ourselves to a point. The ego is just a projection, a motivating device that we have dedicated a part of our mind to. We've dedicated, and we want to get to the point where we say, you know what? Look around and say, you know what? This is so terrible. My circumstances are so terrible. There's no way I could have chosen this. Impossible. It was forced upon me. Therefore, I'm not free. If I was free, I never would have chosen this. Therefore, I've overcome God's will, which is freedom. Therefore, I'm greater than God. Therefore, I'm the prime creator. Therefore, I now choose happiness for myself. So, I'm reiterating this because it's probably never been heard here before. Because we have a continuity problem. And we feel we're incapable of dropping this self-deception, excuse me. Having trouble talking because the nervousness of getting this out in the world, because the world is fanatically opposed to this information. Fanatically opposed because of the continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem we really have. It is the key to resolving this entire situation. Because we're afraid we can't set this down. Because we're afraid of true happiness. Because we're in a situation that, a horrible kind of situation where we're trying to create, we're so used to failure, this feeling of choosing what we don't want. We really don't want to experience. And we're so used to the belief that we're not free. We're so used to then believing we're not happy. We're afraid to set this whole scenario down and say, oh no, I am free. Moments are not bound. I'm free right now, this very instant. I've always been free. I've always chosen, been free to choose. I've just been trying to prove that I'm not free. We're afraid to experience true happiness, true what we really want. We're afraid to experience that, our freedom. That is our happiness, our freedom. Not embracing some idol, okay? Not embracing some form, some definition of what we are. See, this goddess that we think we're going to be able to embrace is a definition of what we are. It's a form, it's an idol. That's not what we want. That's not our freedom. That what we are is, in freedom, we experience essence. We feel and directly feel and experience essence, not form, not definition. So we want to embrace the formless. We want to experience essence. And we want to know our happiness and our freedom. And we're afraid to do so. So we keep trying to succeed at success, and what we do is we keep trying to imagine better and better idols, more and more attractive idols. We think the problem is we haven't found an attractive enough idol yet to succeed at failure, and that we haven't been able to therefore embrace a hideous enough failure to prove that we're not free, right? And therefore to insist that freedom is a failure. And therefore our will caused it to fail. Therefore our will is greater than God. Therefore we are God, the new prime creator. Therefore we have the power to simply will our happiness. And we're happy. So this is the overwhelming trend that we're stuck in because of the continuity fear that we have. That's why I say working on the continuity problem is how we free ourselves. And by working on this intensely, I was able to get the vision of oneness, which is what actually resolves the continuity problem. I was able to get several glimpses of it and hover very near it. This is how we get free. We have to recognize that our real problem is the continuity problem. Even if we see through this deception, we still have the continuity problem. Now, to the extent that we're able to work on the continuity problem and melt away, evaporate a lot of our fear about this, then we can recognize our self-deception. Because in recognizing it, then we get much closer to setting it down, saying, wow, look what I did to myself. And I know I did it to myself. Absolutely, I did it to myself. 100%. I tried to find the greatest idol possible and then use that idol to motivate myself to go into the most extreme failure possible, thinking that then that would result in success, right? I could say, I didn't choose this. But the fact is, I did choose to use an idol. I did choose then to use that idol to deceive myself. And I did choose that failure, hoping that it would prove that I'm not free. I chose all of that. See, this is the honesty we have to have about ourselves. We did choose everything we've experienced. We did choose. The reason why we deny it is we said, no, I thought I was getting something else. But keep in mind, we also chose to use this idol and imagine that that's what we're going to get if we proceeded with this failure. So we did choose it, 100%. We're just thinking that our self-deception means we didn't choose it. No, we did choose all of it. We chose all of it. And so if we can be honest with this, then we say, well, I have been free the whole time. I've always been free in my choosing. But I was very clever in my deception to try and say, well, I never have to admit that I chose this because I will prove that I wasn't free. Like that by, wow, how could I choose these circumstances? That's what I'm saying right now in my life. How could I possibly have chosen the circumstances I'm in? It's just like Armageddon for me, you know. I said, no, I did. Absolutely, I did. By using the idol, you see, thinking that that's what I'm going to get. And this is what the idol wants for me. And the idol could never, such a wonderful idol, could never mislead me. You see, now this must be successful. See, but it was my own choosing of the idol, and using it as a way to motivate myself towards choosing these terrible circumstances, where I complain all the time. I say, God, you must not be God. You know, Holy Spirit, you're a failure, because there's no way that I could be in these terrible circumstances and I still have you, you know, guiding my life. You see, I think you've been guiding my life all along, and look at these circumstances. Therefore, you know, you're a failure. Okay? So it's basically trying to say God's a failure. God's a failure. But what the Holy Spirit has done is clarify the continuity fear enough so I can be honest and see that I've been choosing these circumstances in order to prove that I'm not free. Now here, the continuity problem, it is essential to recognize the continuity problem, because we say, okay, well, let's say I recognize this self-deception, yet the bad circumstances remain. And I say, well, that proves, Holy Spirit, that you can't change circumstances. I'm not free. In other words, I'm not able to choose different circumstances. And he said, if I was free, I should be able to solve this whole situation like that and just choose instantly. I would be happy. I'd be out of this terrible circumstances I'm in. And the Holy Spirit says, wait a minute. You have a severe continuity problem. The reason why, even if you see through the self-deception, the reason why it doesn't clear up immediately is you have this gigantic continuity problem. You're very much used to feeling that the way things are is that nothing works out for you. It all works out the opposite of how you want it to work out. So if it were to work out exactly as you want it to work out, you'd probably get panicky and you think, wait a minute, I'm out of control. Things are not working the way they're supposed to work. That God has gone crazy. You know, my expectations are, everything's happening differently than my expectations. Therefore, I feel I'm in chaos. There's no laws working. You see, we think that deception is some kind of law. It's not a law. It's self-deception is not a law of the universe. It's just how we're trying to prove that the laws of the universe don't work. So we're so used to believing the laws of the universe, or laws of God, let's say, don't work, that if they were to work, instantly, they are working, but the way we're choosing, it seems like they're not. If we were to choose and exactly what we really want, be totally happy right now, we'd say, oh my God, the laws aren't working. So we have this severe continuity problem, severe. And if we accept this is true, then we don't blame God when our circumstances don't change immediately. In once we see through our self-deception, they don't change immediately. That's what I found. I said, even though I see this, I'm still in this terrible situation. And I say, and so it's important when you get to that point not to blame God, not to blame the Holy Spirit, not to say the laws of God don't work, that are free, that we're not free. Because I could say, well, look, I realize self-deception, what I'm doing, and I'm still not free. So that really proves I'm not free. I say, no, it proves that I have a severe continuity problem. And then this is what's called turning the corner. This is what's called turning the corner. This is what enables you to get around the corner. Now, what happens once you get around the corner? Once you get around that corner, you get in touch with your inner truth, with your inner Christ. You meet your inner truth, your inner Christ, your inner happiness, your inner freedom. You turn the corner because you even at this point of what would seem to be utmost despair, where you've seen through self-deception entirely and yet nothing changes, you don't despair because you say, no, I have a terrible continuity problem, but I can work on that. See, that's something I can actually work on. That's when you turn the corner. You see, the ego tells you if you ever get to this point where you see through your self-deception totally and yet nothing changes for you, then the ego says that will cause you total, complete despair and you'll commit spiritual suicide and you realize that is complete failure and you won't be able to handle it. The ego tells you, don't go there, don't go there. But because I worked on the continuity issue, I've been able to go there. So the ego was wrong. You see, the ego refuses to look at the continuity problem because if it does, it knows it's finished. So it insists you do not have a continuity problem. It denies this entirely. So if you take that out of the equation, then the ego would be right. If you get to the point where I'm at and you see through self-deception, nothing changes, then you would like, that would be complete despair for sure. It leaves out the continuity problem. It leaves it out of the equation. But the Holy Spirit doesn't leave it out of the equation. In fact, the Holy Spirit insisted that I work on this tremendous work on the continuity problem so that I could get to this point. And the Holy Spirit says, don't worry, don't worry, don't worry. When you get to this point, you will not despair as the ego tells you will. The ego's wrong about this because it doesn't account for the continuity issue that you've worked on it, you're aware of it. So here I am at a situation that seems to me my life is like this just catastrophic failure. And I've seen how I got myself into it. It's all self-deception. And yet nothing has changed. I still am in this terrible situation. And I say, I'm still calm. I'm not hating myself. I'm not hating God. I'm not hating the Holy Spirit. I'm not super angry. I'm not freaking out. Which is a miracle, right? The ego will say, well, it's a miracle. No, it's not a miracle, actually. It's because I worked on the continuity problem and I accept that the only problem I have is the continuity problem. That's it. And I know how to work on the continuity problem. That is why I'm still calm. That is the reason. I know that step by step my circumstances can improve. The Holy Spirit, I can choose bit by bit by bit to have circumstances improve so that my expectations don't get trampled on too severely. You know, the continuity problem. One second. So I'm not claiming any miracle here at all, actually. The ego will say it's a miracle. I say, no, 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 it's not. Because the ego wants to say it's a miracle so that nobody actually looks at what actually happened and realizes, hey, I have a continuity problem too. See, the ego wants to say, oh no, this is just some incredible miracle that happened that is cannot be explained at all. No, that's a lie. That's a lie of the ego. It was simply hard work on my part that got me here. It is simply the willingness to accept I have a severe continuity problem and to work on it. And put all my work on around this issue. That is what got me to this turning the corner. That and only that got me to this. Had nothing to do with any miracles whatsoever. Again, the ego will say, oh, he is able to turn the corner and not despair. The ego will say, a total miracle. And the ego, in other words, what the ego is saying to everybody else is, you can't count on that. This is just like some fluke, bizarre miracle thing that's like one in a trillion, and it's completely unexplainable. So there's nothing to see there. You know, you just have to accept it. Well, he's, you know, just a miracle, and go on with your lives. This is a lie. This is the ultimate lie of the ego. That it's a miracle. It is not a miracle. It's 100% not a miracle. It's 100% hard work. It's 100% dedication. It's 100% listening to the Holy Spirit clarify for me and being able to be in a mood of repentance and being able to accept that, you know what, I've tried to this self-deception for so long, I believed in failure for so long that I'm afraid to let go of it. I'm afraid to choose happiness immediately because I think there's some sort of other laws at work, you know, the laws of lack of freedom at work. It's a continuity issue. I'm afraid of happiness. I'm afraid of pure happiness. I'm afraid of my freedom. Absolutely. Because I'm not used, I feel I wouldn't know how to function. You know, no form. How can I function without definition, without form? You know, see? It's a continuity problem that we have. And so, The whole spiritual path boils down to accepting that you have a continuity problem. And therefore working on it. Being willing to directly work on it. And say, I don't have a, you know, this problem. I don't have a world problem. I don't have a failure problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a lack of freedom problem. I have a continuity problem. And insisting on this, so this is how, when I insisted on it with tremendous will, the vision of one has just opened up for me, just like that. And it's just like, wow. Now it seemed like a miracle, because I said, how could this be so successful, so quickly? And I've never, you know, it was like, no one else is even talking about this. What's going on? It wasn't a miracle, it was just doing what works, is all it was. Insisting. With will and spirit and determination, I only have a continuity problem. I have no other problem. I have absolutely no other problem but the continuity problem, which is true. That's a true statement. Then you align your will with God. You're agreeing with God, you see, instead of saying no, that there's some other will that has different laws, you see, and I have to reconcile these two. You know, no, that's not true. No, there's only one will. It's the will of God. And I, believing that there was another will, that I could cause failure of God's will, this has only brought up a severe continuity problem of expectation. See, expectation. And so I have to act as if there were another will, but gradually let go of that in my experiencing. In other words, feel more and more freedom, more and more happiness, more and more peace. And vision of oneness, seeing, oh, there's only one. Now, several days ago, I was actually watching a baseball game or something on TV. I did practice during the day. I said, my one self is my salvation. Salvation comes from my one self. Thoughts of my one self are mine to use. The thoughts of my one self are mine to use. I was practicing that all day. That's a exercise in A Course in Miracles, actually. My one self is my salvation comes from my one self. The thoughts of my one self are mine to use. And I suddenly saw that everyone was me. There was only one self. All people are just the one self. Everything is me, and I am everything. Everything is me. There's only this one self. I was able to see that, just faintly. It's just like, wow. What is that? That's a thought of our one self, isn't it? The thoughts of my one self are mine to use. Are mine to use. So, This is working on the continuity problem, but to assert it with will and determination is what is important. It cannot just be a mindless repetition. It has to be asserted with will. I chose all these circumstances to try and prove that I was not free. So of course, I find myself in circumstances that are designed to bring about the collapse of the body, being my chosen instrument to prove that I'm not free. And we're extremely clever about all this, actually. Extremely clever. How step by step by step we arrange circumstances to bring about our failure in life here. And the body is its journey through these circumstances. It is to cause, to run it into the ground, run it into failure. Now, why don't certain lives fail terribly? Because they're just going down that pathway, working on it cleverly to orchestrate it. So they, self-deception takes a lot of orchestration, and you have to actually be very skillful in it. And see, that's not normal for spirit to try and deceive itself. So it takes a lot of lifetimes before you can orchestrate, a terrible failure of your life. So everything just sort of collapses in on you horribly. Normally you go through life and you survive pretty well and you're able to do things and then you die. But to bring about a circumstances where you just feel you can't function at all, it takes a lot of lifetimes to be able to work on idols to such an extent where you can imagine an idol so attractive that you can attract yourself to all these missteps, so many missteps against your better judgment, misstep after misstep. So you bring yourself into a situation where you feel you can't function at all. You're completely imprisoned and paralyzed. You can't move at all. It's difficult, very difficult to get to this place where I've gotten to. It takes many lifetimes. So that's why most people seem to have a job. They seem to function pretty well in life, in existence. They haven't got to the point where they can motivate themselves to more severe failure. They're not being able to imagine an idol beautiful, attractive enough to deceive themselves enough. You see, that's why. But I was able to do that. I was able to get to the point where I was able to deceive myself to an extraordinary extent through imagining an idol so perfect that I could trust it totally. You see, I could totally trust this idol. That's what I believe. And therefore, whatever missteps I took, I'd say, no, I'm sure this idol is guiding me properly. Now, it takes a lot of doing, many lifetimes to get to this point. So there you go. You've got the inside scoop on existence. The inside scoop on existence. Now, will I get out of this? I don't know. We'll see. We'll see. Have I managed to bring about the is the momentum? Now, momentum, there's no such thing as momentum. This is the next step for me, is to realize there's no such thing as momentum. There is no momentum. There's a feeling that feels like momentum, and we identify this feeling as momentum. Okay. So I believe I have all this momentum because I have this feeling, this terrible feeling. And I say, well, this is all this momentum that is forcing me forward. Actually, it isn't. It's just a feeling of investment in all this, that I have to succeed at this, at failure, that causes me to continue to choose failure each moment, moment by moment by moment. But truth be told, there is no such thing as momentum. I realized that this morning. So that is how I can suddenly get out of this situation I'm in, is to drop this feeling of momentum. You see, the idea of succeeding at this is we believe there's this massive momentum pushing us. There isn't any such thing. There's only our moment by moment choice. So there's zero momentum to reality. Reality has no momentum whatsoever. There is no momentum. Now, this is the next step for me to realize that. Once I accept this and I'm well on my way, my circumstances are likely to change very quickly. I've seen that already. My circumstances, this terrible feeling I'm underwater, You talk about being underwater on a mortgage. I'm like underwater on my life. Totally. That's gonna just vanish like in an instant. because I'll realize there's zero momentum to that. There's no momentum to failure. See, we believe, the way we keep ourselves believing in failure, along with this idol, beautiful idol, we think that's what we're going to get. Along with believing that once we succeed, we'll decree our happiness. Along with that, we feel we have this massive momentum that's going to enable us to succeed. If we didn't believe in momentum, then we couldn't keep working on it because we'd say, well, wait a minute. The very next instant, I could choose what I really want. There is no momentum binding me to the next, binding the next moment at all. So we'd say, well, how could I possibly succeed at failure? I don't want this. So we have to believe in momentum, which is what we call karma. Okay, I've always said there's no such thing as karma, actually. It's a belief. It's a belief. It's how we bind ourselves, how we believe we're bound. We say, no, all this momentum is forcing me to choose. Forcing me to choose. I have no, it's, but the momentum isn't there. It's a feeling we have of unhappiness, of failure, of misery. It's this, of fear. It's really the feeling of fear. And we say, we claim it's some sort of law of physics, of existence, of life. It's momentum, we say. It's not. That's why I had this dream where I was underwater. And the water was weighing me down horribly. I said, I can't move, I can't move, I can't move. It's been the feeling my whole life, I can't move. And I was able to somehow get some light into my experience here. And then suddenly that broke this feeling, the weight of the feeling. I was able to move a little bit. I was able to move a little bit. And suddenly all this water, it was symbolized by water, like a flood. I was under all this heavy water. It all went down this drain. I was on the toilet in the bathroom. And all this water went down the toilet, as it were. Being on the toilet symbolizes failure. It went down the drain of the toilet. Instantly, the whole bathroom full of water. Gone down the drain. It didn't like gradually vortex gradually down the toilet and take like, you know, must have, you know, a couple hours to drain all that water, maybe. It went down instantly gone. I saw it all gone. Physics, law of physics makes it says that's impossible. The law of momentum would say that's impossible. Obviously there's no such thing as momentum. I saw it. I said, okay. Now, I was sitting on a sofa, a bench outdoors a couple days ago. I was so tired and feeling so defeated. I closed my eyes, just resting, and the sunlight was hitting my eyes. And I focused my attention behind the eyes, so to speak, and I saw all this beautiful tracery. Maybe it's floaters in my eyes, maybe it's just the structure of my eyeball or something, whatever. But I saw this golden light and all this exquisitely beautiful tracery of white, sort of white and golden light with subtle forms moving about. It was just extremely beautiful. I said, wow, this is so, so beautiful, amazing. But that wasn't all. As I was watching this golden light, slowly there was this kind of an expanding, a surge, or a slow pulse, as it were, a gentle slow pulse, and it all intensified, and then it like a beating of a heart. Like imagine a heart slowly beating, slow beat, and then the heart contracts, a slow expansion and contraction. There's a slow expansion. And then the expansion subsided. Okay, it was like that. And as this expanded, the golden light became more intense and more beautiful and more saturated. I was like, what in the world was that? And then it subsided. So a slow expansion of the beauty and then subsidence. But that is not all. It came back, like in about 4 or 5 seconds or so. It came back, expansion of the the golden light became even more golden, and the beauty became even more beauty. It swelled and expanded, and then it contracted, subsided. I said, wow. And then it did it again, and again, and again. And this kept going on for about 5 minutes or so, with my eyes closed. I was saying, what in the world is this? I said, well, maybe it's my heart beating and the blood is going to my brain. But no, because like as every 5 seconds, my heart is beating about once every second. It wasn't my heart that was doing it. It was not the circulation of my blood. It wasn't anything that I can account for physiologically that was doing this. So I could say, well, the effect is the sunlight hitting my eye and there's some sort of tracery behind that. I'm getting electric, you know, I'm looking at the imagery of that. But what's accounting for this pulsation, this slow expansion and contraction, this slow expansion and then subsidence? What was causing that? This was something coming from spirit. It was something coming from my you know, inner spirit somehow. And it wasn't scary at all. It was just like incredibly beautiful. And then I opened my eyes, and then I put shade in my eyes, and that interfered with it. And at some point I said, stop this, because I was afraid. I said, I don't understand what's causing this. And then I said, no, that's a continuity fear. I said, that's just my continuity fear, let's stay with this. And so it continued. So I was a little jittery and nervous, actually, about it. I said, what's going on? Is there some, you know, malfunction of my body, my brain, I couldn't account for what's causing it. So that brought the fear, but I identified it. I said, this is a continuity fear. Okay, this is just a continuity fear. Let's stick with it. Use my will to stick with this. And I was able to do it. So something as profound is going on here for sure. And I don't know. I wasn't expecting that. Although in the dream, that dream of sitting on the toilet in the bathroom, being underwater, there was this, somehow I was able to pulse this golden light into the water, underwater, as it were. That was in the dream, and that was able to break this some kind of spell or vacuum. Enabled them to get all the water disappear, and then I was like, all the weight was off of me entirely, just like that. The weight was lifted off of me instantly. I was able to function again. So the feeling I have in life right now is I'm totally underwater. I have this like the weight of the world. I can't move, I can't function, I can't hardly do anything. I'm completely weighted down. I can't think, I can't function, I can't survive. Everything, trying to do anything, seems to be incredibly difficult. I can hardly take the simplest step, you know, I don't understand how anyone can function or survive in this world. It seems to me impossible. It's that intense weight on me. But in that dream, it all vanished in an instant. And then I had no weight on me at all. I cannot even conceive at this point how to function successfully in life. I can't even conceive. I don't understand how people do it. I really don't. Because I've been trying to bring this intense failure upon myself. So it's going to be quite a surprise to function, to feel like I can function. That will be like, wow, what is this? Because the weight of this failure has been on me for so long, so long. But it's coming. The freedom from the heaviness is coming, and it is around momentum. There is no momentum. There's never been any momentum. And of course, seeing this realizes that I didn't ever build up any momentum towards succeeding with failure. You can't build up momentum. It was all self-deception. And the continuity fear, using the continuity fear to keep motivating myself. But once we realize directly what the continuity fear is, we can turn that around and use that to free ourselves from motivating our motivation towards failure. We can work on the continuity problem. It says, I don't have any of these other problems. I have a continuity problem, and I can work on that by rehearsing happiness, true happiness, not an idol of happiness, but how happiness is genuinely going to feel. And experiencing it, that experience I had of that light, the pulsing of that light, the expansion and subsidence, the arising and subsidence, the intensification. I experience intensification. That helps out. You see, that helps say, hey, at some level I said, hey, I can do that. That wasn't bad. That wasn't bad. I said, in fact, that was wonderful. In fact, that was wonderful. I said, that's not a problem, really. Somehow that broke the spell. That broke the spell of somehow experiencing light, the inner light directly, and how it can intensify. At some level, that it broke the spell. Now, I haven't experienced that on the conscious here, in you know, since then. But I have to believe it's coming. And there wasn't any definable, I said, it was like all this beautiful free-floating tracery that I was seeing with my eyes closed. I can't define any form at all. It was these like fragments. There wasn't any defined form at all, but these beautiful white kind of filigree tracery that looked like pieces of some exquisite lace or something, you might say, but it was all this exquisite lace work, but not attached as in one piece of lace tracery, as it were, white, golden white light tracery with the golden light surrounding it. I couldn't define it as any particular form in this world, or any form at all. It wasn't form. It was free-floating tracery, as it were. And I just let it be that way. I wasn't trying to delineate it as some kind of form. And I didn't have any problem with that at all. So that's an experience of experiencing an experience that's undefined in terms of form and being comfortable with it. That's super important. That's why a lot of videos, I did a lot of work trying to produce a video effects that give a sense of formlessness. Don't try to define what you're seeing. It's free-floating, free-form. And don't try to say, oh, that looks like a dog, or that looks like a cat, or that looks like a leaf. No. What we see is, it looks beautiful. This is beautiful. Just as it is, it's beautiful. Just as it is. I don't need to delineate it. Because myself, I am not delineated. What I am is not delineated. It is the absence of delineation. It is the absence of definition. It is the absence of form. What I am cannot, pure freedom cannot be defined, can it? It cannot be defined by any experience. If that's true, it wouldn't be free, would it? Because you'd say, I need this particular experience in order to be free. I need this particular delineation in order to be free. I need this valuing in order to be free. And then you wouldn't be free, because you'd fear the lack of that valuing. You think it'd be your death, would be your lack of freedom. It would be the end of your identity, end of your life. So you have to cling to this delineation, which is what we're doing here with this world in existence. We think without all this valuing, we would be annihilated. Without definitions of what we are, delineations, we'd be no identity. We'd be in an abyss. That's not true at all. So this experience I had was just this incredible beauty without any delineation. There was no human form. No human forms. No animate forms. No inanimate forms. It was this floating tracery. of lines, you know, lines that did not delineate anything. Symbols that don't symbolize anything, that were, you know, no need to put them together. I had no, it wasn't like, it was like, let's say, pieces of a jigsaw puzzle, for example. All just floating about in golden light. And each piece is so beautiful, and the light is so beautiful. There's no thought of saying, wait a minute, I need to fit all these pieces of the jigsaw puzzle to get there to get a picture. No, you said just the form of that piece of a jigsaw puzzle, just as it is beautiful. There's no reason to fit it together to delineate anything in particular. And the tracery changed. You'd see it for a little while, and then it seemed to just sort of dissolve away. And this was sort of something would arise, and it would dissolve away. And it was like that. It was like watching beautiful fragments of clouds, cloud fragments, without having to say, what does this cloud remind me of? Or, I need this cloud to stay as it is. I said, no, if it wants to fade away, fine, because others are coming too. It was like that. I just let it float, let the appearances arise and dissolve, arise and subside, without trying to define anything. That was the experience. It was easy, no problem. Now, of course, the ego is telling me if I post this and we're through. If you walk out on me, we're through. you'll never can use me as motivation again. You can never have a beautiful idol again to motivate you. I don't need a beautiful idol. You know, seeing the golden light and this tracery of like clouds, beautiful white tracery, like little wisps of clouds arising and dissolving. That was wonderful. Yeah, then I don't need to identify. I don't need to define what I am. I don't need to define freedom. We don't have to put pieces of a puzzle together for a definition. To say this is life, this is form, this is what I am. Everything is already one. Our freedom is already one. Everything already arises in the golden light of oneness. There isn't a need to fit anything together. There's no need to arrange or harmonize anything. See, there's no need to arrange or harmonize. For everything to be beautiful. Everything, for beauty to be seen, the beauty of oneness to be seen. So the ego keeps saying, if you walk out on me, we're through. If you walk out on me, we're through. You know, no more momentum. I'll never be able to build momentum again. Well, there is no momentum. I never built any momentum. Only built up fear, a fearful feeling. But that's no momentum. There's no such thing as momentum in reality. Each moment is totally free and clear of every other moment. We're totally free. So how could there be momentum? How could a moment have momentum? It doesn't. Momentum means that it would influence the choice of the next moment. That somehow, inevitably, it forces the next moment to be chosen as the way you choose it. There's no such thing as momentum. There's no principle of momentum. None. Now, in a dream last night, I was there just like this. Like tortoise or something with a hard shell, real hard shell, defensive shell, right? and something about this Taurus was loose, and it was like, so this is the most dangerous animal possible. Don't, I was told, at all cost, you cannot allow this animal to escape or get loose or whatever in the house or something. We gotta find this. It was somewhere loose, we had to find it. It was super important, and nobody could locate it, but I didn't give up. And there was this maid in the house, and this maid was cleaning up, and this maid had this garbage bag, and this maid poured this garbage sack into another one or something she was going to take out, put somewhere. And I happened to be watching this, and I saw as the maid was pouring this garbage out, this tortoise shell, whatever this shell, this animal, very dangerous critter. I saw it slip. It was in the garbage, disguised, and very quickly it slid into the other garbage bag. It was transferred, but I saw it in that instant. I had to be paying attention. That very instant, I saw it. And then the maid wrapped up the garbage. She was taking it out. And I said, whoa, wait a minute. She said, come back here. She goes, why? I was taking the garbage. I said, no. Come here and open up the garbage. She goes, no, why do I want to open up garbage? You know, that's. I said, no, I'm telling you to open up that garbage. That tortoise is in that garbage. I saw it. And there's a lot of resistance. People said, no, it's because this nuts. What are you talking about? I said, I insisted on it. Opened it up. I said, I'll prove it to you. It's there. Opened it up. There it was. Then I took it and I hosed it off and cleaned it off. And then someone else says, okay, yeah, you found it. That's great. What do we do with it now? And someone said, well, I can take it to my house and let it just graze outside. It won't cause any problems. There's some way to deal with the situation without destroying it or something. You know, but it was okay. But that was the essential insight. I was able to catch. Now, what does this maid stand for? Ma-id. What is M-A-I-D? The ma-id. Okay, the ma-id. For me, that's very significant. What's the id in psychoanalytic structure? The ego and the id. Isn't the id some kind of the deeper instinctiveness that we have? It stands for something in psychoanalytical theory, right? I used to know all that stuff very well. The ma stands for the mother principle. Now, the mother principle, I was driving yesterday, and there was this large group of young school children, maybe preschool or kindergarten children, and they're going on a field trip. They're going to the park or something. So there's all these children marching together, and they were surrounded by this phalanx of teachers who were taking them on this field trip. Okay. Now, of course, every single one of them were women. And I looked at it, and the kids are feeling so trustful. They're trusting, like, as long as these teachers are here, it's like my mother. The young children, they trust their mother, and the children are trusting the teachers. Everything's fine. They're not worried about anything. They feel safe. We, the body form and the id, this instinctive feeling of survival and safety that we have in the world, is based on our mother. Mother gives birth to us. The mother takes care of us as we're young, we're helpless, we're feeling, you know, where's my safety? Oh, the mother makes sure I'm safe. And as we grow up, even as little school children, it's our teachers, our female teachers, they make sure we trust them that they're, you know, we trust them that they'll keep our safety. We entrust our safety to the mother. That is the basic pattern of physical form, animate form, of human animate form. So, if we want to trust in something, it's very likely to be a female form, especially in situations where we feel very almost helpless and nervous, like a little infant, like super dangerous situations. So if we're trying to lead ourselves into a marriage with severe failure, in other words, severe danger to our survival, and we need an idol to believe in, that everything's fine, I know this is perfectly fine, actually, why am I worrying? The mother image is the one we're going to choose, almost inevitably. Almost inevitably, the idol will be a female idol that we will we will make to us, we'll believe it's a mother. We'll believe it's our mother. Oh, my mom, my mother is saying it's okay. Therefore, it must be okay. So we tend to infantize ourselves. And so the idol is this beautiful mother, but the perfect mother. We said, I can trust this perfect mother implicitly. There's no way she can mislead me. Because that brings us back to our infancy and how our mother took care of us. And as we grew up, we're surrounded by our mother, our friends, our grandmothers, our aunties, you see, our sisters, whatever. The female, the ma principle, the mother principle, takes care of us in our infancy in situations of vulnerability, where we're vulnerable. So as we're trying to embrace vulnerability and failure of the body and, you know, catastrophe for ourselves, what we do is we believe in a mother idol. And we, in our imagination, we see this mother, this perfect mother, and that she's the one beckoning us, saying, "It's safe, don't worry, it's safe, you can come here to me, come to me, come to me." And we're looking, and there's this like chasm or something, or this road, steep cliff, or road down to hell. We're looking, oh my God, and the mother's beckoning, saying, no, come to me, come to me, everything's safe. And we say, well, I guess I can trust this perfect mother, she won't mislead me. And what happens, of course, we go down into hell. So this maid, this ma-id, was trying to deceive me, and I saw it. I said, ah, you see, she's trying to slip this super hard defensiveness, somehow trying to keep this momentum of this going. And I caught her. I caught her, and I called her on it. And she's had to open up, and I proved I was right. The ma-id, the maid. The genius of us is beyond comprehension. That's why dreams are so difficult to understand, because the intelligence of the dream is totally beyond what we believe our intelligence is. So it's super difficult to understand dreams, actually. Very difficult. But our dreams are an amalgamation of our intelligence that is free of time and space and is able to put things together in like this gestalt wholeness for us. That pictures for us what we need to see. It's quite amazing, actually. I mean, how you know why the figure, this female figure, and then in the guise of a maid, would triggers this real ma-id, you know, M-A-I-D, M-A-I-D, the trust in, instinctive trust in the mother figure to lead us into vulnerable situations. Now, what I have seen and talked about in many videos is, I say that the world is being infantized, and there is absolutely no question about that. I've talked about commercials, how the whole advertising industry adapted this what you call it, a Mimi, or a basic psychic genome, as it were, the archetype principle of advertising, where the woman is always right and the man is always wrong, and the men are always portrayed in a role in ways that infantize them, that make them feel that they're an infant, and the female in all the advertising is always portrayed in a way which symbolizes them in a way which makes them seem as the mother figure, as the all-knowing mother who knows what is best for the infant, the child, knows how to protect the child from vulnerability. Okay, I noticed this. The Holy Spirit told me, look at this, watch, see what's going on, all this advertising. And it's continued nonstop to this day. It's been going on for like 25 years, and intensely. Well, since 105, let's say 20 years, about 20 years, give or take. And the purpose is, I was pointed out to me, when was it? I think it was the late 90s or something, but it may have been going on before that. But it's been going on for a long time, more than 15 years, let's say. Intensely, this is intense. This all purpose, there's a purpose behind this. And the purpose is for us to believe that we're going towards success. that we have all these women. And there's another thing that, as I pointed out, after every sporting contest, anyone who has that does something great, a man does something great, no matter what sport it is, he's always interviewed by this woman who acts like a mother, talking to a child, actually. This is all designed, again, to infantize males and make them feel that the mother principle, the ma-id, is trustworthy and believable, and that, you know, a guy does something really great, and then he's talking to his mother. The mother's interviewing. He's like, "Hey, little Johnny, you know, you kind of did nice out there. You know, like you're like a 5-year-old at a soccer match, and you did good." And the mother says, "Oh, you know, aren't you wonderful? Aren't you wonderful?" "Yes, yeah, mom, yeah, mom, yeah, mom." It's like that. It's designed to infantize males. This whole principle of these having these females interviewing after every sporting event, anything that happens. "You know, I just won the Super Bowl. Here's the lady to talk to," you know, and say, "Gee." And it talks to you, it makes the man look like an idiot. You know, the men are being infantized by the way they're interacting with these women, and they have to be so subservient to this interviewer, you know. You can't just say, "Hey, I don't want to talk to you. I just won the Super Bowl. I want to be with my fellow warriors, you know, that helped me succeed, the fellow cooperators. You know, this is an intense moment. This is profound for me. I just overcome great odds." No, I'm having to talk to this ditzy, you know, reporter who's asking me these stupid questions, like, "Gee, you know, how does this rank there up, and how do you feel about this?" And gee, this is all purposeful. You have these hosts on television, have these talk shows, a lot of them have more and more females in there, who are infantizing their guests entirely, totally infantizing them. The whole culture, this whole culture of entertainment and news and everything is designed, actually, a purpose to infantize males. Why? Because males are the ones most likely to say, "Whoa, wait a minute. I feel like my survival is being threatened here by what's going on. I'm going to look into this," you know. That's not men's job. Men's job is to be able to ascertain threat to survival in an advanced way. That's our job. We're watchdogs. We go out, we roam, we go out far afield, saying, "Wait a minute, there's an asteroid coming. Hey, wait a minute, let's develop telescopes. Let's find out what's happening, you know. Wait a minute, well, there's an asteroid coming to us," because we developed all these sophisticated scientific capabilities to determine at a distance, you know. Or, "Hey, an earthquake is coming." For me, like, one of my hobbies is to try and predict earthquakes, and I've had some tremendous successes, and I've had some that are not so successful, but more successes than not. I've actually been able to determine to the very day when an earthquake is going to happen. That's a tremendous effort on my part to do this. So that's a characteristic that men are able to do. So if we want to lead ourselves into a terrible, catastrophic situation for the purpose of what? You should know by now. The purpose of being able to say, "There is no way in heck that I could ever have chosen this for myself. It must have been imposed upon me. Therefore, I am not free. Therefore, my will triumphed over God's. And therefore, I am prime creator." If we want to lead ourselves into such a situation, we have to have this idol that we believe in, that overcomes our inner reservation, better judgment. The men on the planet are the ones that are able to determine coming disasters at a distance. They're very adept. I know I'm very adept at this, very adept. Therefore, if we determine, "Wait a minute, this is disaster coming, I can see it," then we'll take steps to avoid it. Then it won't happen so bad to us. Then we will not experience such severe failure. Therefore, we will not say, "Wait a minute, I know way I could possibly have chosen this." We'll say, "Well, maybe I did choose the situation, it's not that bad." So the whole point of the situation in this world now, I've been very aware of this, is to get men to be so, dumb them down, stupefy them, so they won't even speak up, also feel afraid to speak up about disasters that are coming, failure that is coming. And how do we do this? Is to put women in charge to such an extent, and to infantize men to think that they don't have any right to speak up, or if they do, they're foolish or stupid, to think that they're incapable of determining these disasters that are coming, and to see them ahead of time, and therefore to sidestep them. They're incapable of being men, essentially. Because a man will stand up and say, "Hey, you know, there's this disaster coming. You need to take steps to do it. That's what I am. That's what I was born as. And I would stand up and I would say, hey, folks, you know, and I would tell people directly without any fear. That's what a man is. It's been a dedicated effort for the last 50 years to emasculate men on this planet. So they will not stand up and say what's happening. So that the disaster, this terrible situation will come upon the world. Therefore, the whole world will say it's impossible that we chose this for ourselves. Therefore, we are not free. Therefore, our will has overcome God. Therefore, we are greater than God. Therefore, now we can all collectively will happiness for ourselves. This is the whole point of these times that we live in. The whole point on a collective, global scale. And you're not hearing it because men have been emasculated in this planet. That is the entire plan. The big mother. We don't have big brother, we have big mother. We have a nanny state, we have a maid state, a ma-id state, where men are too intimidated now to speak up and speak the truth here about what's going on. They feel they're wrong, they would upset the mother. The mother wouldn't like that. And they're so enamored of this idol, mother idol, who's beckoning them, the siren that's beckoning them. You know, that's the whole point of pornography too, and all these beautiful, glamorous women being used in advertising. It is to spellbind men into thinking that, oh, I could have this, I'm gonna have this, if I just keep going that direction, everything will be great. You see, emasculating men, a real man is not will not put up with that. He will not sell out the planet just because he thinks he's going to get a beautiful prostitute for himself. See what I'm saying? He'll say, no, forget it. I'm going to, my job is to warn, speak up and warn, you know, speak truth to the situation here. And say, wait a minute, we are aware that this is coming upon us. Therefore, to some extent, we must be choosing it. If we allow it to come upon us, we're choosing that. You see, that's a step towards realization. I was born with precognition. I knew what was going to happen, but the world is so against that I dumbed myself down severely. But I used to be able to know everything that was going to happen ahead of time. Everything, as I know exactly what's going to happen. And there's this flowing with everything. See, I know that's going to happen. I'm choosing it. It's being chosen. We're collectively choosing everything here. We're all one self, actually. And the world hated that, hated me because I was aware it was going to happen. I stood up and said, this is what's going to happen. And then when it happened, they said, oh my God, I could have avoided that because I was warned. So I chose not to avoid it. Means, so I was complicit in this. You see what I'm saying? We want to be able to say as a world that all this stuff just happened to us without any warning whatsoever. And there's no way we could have escaped it or avoided it or sidestepped it. That is what our aim as a planet is. And that is why we're using this female mother ma-id idol as collectively as a planet, that to bow and worship the feminine, the great mother, so idol, and infantize men so they won't speak up. And also get men so besotted with this image of this beautiful whore, basically, female mother whore, that is so beautiful and beguiling. They think, oh, I'm ready to embrace her, you know, while we're falling into this abyss, this pit. This is the facts of the situation. So a real man speaks facts to the situation, okay? And there are very few real men left in the world. Very few, but there's some on some level. There's resistance to what's taking place at a small level. Here, I'm pointing out the whole global, deep dynamic of the situation, which is mean intense resistance to the situation, intense clarity on the whole situation. I call this channel pure clarity. So we're speaking of the total clarity on the entire situation. But there are men in the world who are standing up saying, hey, wait a minute, you know, wait a minute. And there are women who are supporting that. They're saying, yeah, you know, we want some truth here. We want some clarity here. But there's also a fanatical activist, blitzkrieg taking place in this planet over the last 50 years or so to wipe that out, to eliminate it, to shame men into silence when they see something that's not right. And there's many, 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 many events that take place in the media that try to steamroll everybody into silence. You know, like, oh yeah, I can't say it. I can't say a word about that. If you do, you're sexist, you're racist, you're homophobic, you're bigoted, you're you know, every evil under the sun. That's part of it too. Whereas if you speak truth, you're totally evil, you're totally wicked, you know, you're totally terrible person. That's been drilled into men, drilled into them. And the younger men are I don't know how the younger men are able to be true men at all, but some are. They're able to say no to it. It's amazing. Kudos to them, really, because they've been under the most intense brainwashing in history. In history. At least I had some exposure to real men growing up, you know, who weren't afraid to speak their mind. You see, in older people, they're not afraid to speak their mind, you know. They still open their mouths, but, and all the younger people, you know, oh my God, you know, like, what a terrible, sexist, racist, homophobic, awful, evil person they are, you know. Hope they die soon, you know. That's their attitude, you know, of the young who've been so brainwashed and indoctrinated. But now you see, now you've heard in this video the entire story, whistleblowing in the most extreme way possible here. This is the total whistleblower video here. That explains to you why this globe is engaged in this. We want a collective experience of such intense failure that collectively we say that it's impossible we could have chosen this. Therefore, we're not free. Therefore, our will must have overcome God's will, which is freedom for us. Therefore, we're greater than God. Therefore, we are the new prime creator now. We will happy for in us. We will happiness for us. Presto, change-o, magically, golden age. Just like that. That's the belief in this golden age that's coming. Okay. But first, this insane failure that's going to be so terrible, we insist we couldn't have chosen it. And how do we lead ourselves into this extreme failure step by step? Well, men would not have allowed that. They would have said, no. We have to have this mother principle in the world, this feminine female principle. Attracting us, saying, no, you're not, as I said before, as you see this terrible failure embracing you, you back off. But instead, arranger of marriage with failure says, no, look at me. Imagine that you're going to be embracing me. This golden age where this goddess is so beautiful, you're embracing this golden age, and it's symbolized by this wonderful, you know, goddess-like figure. That is everything you could ever possibly want in form, you know, beauty in form. And you think that's what you're getting. That's the trick that's been used. That's why all the pornography has been spread over the whole planet to cast a spell upon men. Otherwise, they'd be speaking up. All the drugs have been spread over the planet. All this music has spread all over the planet. All this rotten culture has been spread over the planet by Hollywood, entertainment industry, etc. This rottenness is so that especially the men, think, oh, this is what I'm getting, this is what I'm getting. So they don't say anything, they don't speak up, they don't function the way they're supposed to function. It's all by design. And now again, we have this overwhelming big mother state, nanny state in the world, where you don't dare speak truth to women anymore in this world. Just the thought of it, if you just think of speaking up and admonishing them or saying no to if they're trying to press failure upon you, say, no, I don't want that. You suddenly get shaking and panic attack inside. You say, I can't say that. Everyone will, like, turn on me and say, you need to be dragged away to Siberia. You just imagine. It used to happen, like, they have these female reporters after this, you know, hard-fought, incredible victory of some contest. And okay, coach, you know, jumps in front of him. You know, here I am, coach, and like tackles him almost and says, okay, you got to talk to me. You have to talk to me. You have to talk to the woman. I'm the one in charge of all this, you know. And the coach says, I don't want to talk to you. And he says, forget it, you know. I'm not interested in that. I'm not playing that game. Everyone's like, huh? What? Oh, this is a sexist situation going on here. This is this male shamanism here. We can't have that. We've got to change the culture. Something's terribly wrong with this culture. Look how he mistreated that woman, you know. That's happened over and over and over again. Yet females in male locker rooms now, okay, invading male locker rooms, which is the sanctity of maleness in this world, of men being able to feel like men and saying, hey, I can stand up to failure, and I can identify failure. Females are allowed in male locker rooms and totally emasculating men. You don't allow men in female locker rooms, okay? So all of this is by design, is to make men feel like little boys who what? Depend on mother for their safety, to tell them what is safe and what is not safe. And so we have this, our male consciousness is so clouded by this now that they will believe in this, what the big mother of popular culture, which is what the big mother is now, of the news and information entertainment networks of this planet, and all the queen bees of the planet, they will believe what these queen bees tell them is safe. They'll believe it, and they'll walk right into catastrophe. You see, that's the setup. We've been set up on this planet. It's a setup. And I've known this all along. Nobody would believe me. They say, oh, you're crazy. You know, when you grow up, you'll think otherwise. No. When I grew up, it's gotten worse and worse. And what they mean is, it'll get so bad, you won't even know what's going on. And that's how bad it is right now. You know, as a man, we live in terror because we know what's going on, but to speak up seems to be disaster for us. We'll be completely cut off. We'll be the worst pariah on the planet. You know, we'll seem to be, you know, anti-woman, that kind of thing. That's how it's put. It's a war against women, is how they put it. So if men were to speak up and say what's really going on, which is their role here, if women were to be real men, they would be absolutely castigated and cut off as saying, you're anti-woman. You see, you're against women. You're trying to force women back into the kitchen. You're trying to force them. No, we're just trying to function the way that we're supposed to function, which is to point out danger, failure, catastrophe ahead of time so we can sidestep. You see, that's what's really going on. So the ego has gained such a powerful position on this planet that we're headed for catastrophe, and nobody will see it coming because we're confused about cause and effect. We're confused, not realizing we're choosing it. We're deceiving ourselves here. Severe self-deception on this planet right now. Severe. And too few men are speaking up about it. Too few men are speaking up about it. And women don't dare speak up because they'll be cut off too. They'll be ostracized severely. They want to. I've noticed too that what happens. Oh, you're not part of the sisterhood. They're told, listen, just go along with this. And once we have this failure, perfect failure, that proves that we're greater than God, then we'll have this golden age and we'll have everything you ever wanted. And they kind of say, oh, wow, okay. They've been cowed, you know. And all of those who want to support truth have been cowed on this planet to an extreme extent. This is the modern world. This is the modern deception. This is what's really taking place on this planet. You know, so I'm a pariah for saying all this stuff, you know. Well, we'll see how that works out. We will see how that works out. Because I know the only problem I have is a continuity problem. I don't have a pariah problem. I have a continuity problem, okay? I don't have a pop culture problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a queen bee problem. I have a continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. And the Holy Spirit's going to take care of that problem for me. So that's why I can speak up. But literally has taken an entire life dedicated to working on this in order to be able to speak up like this. Otherwise, there's no way in the world I could speak up like this. No way. And I'm not speaking up on specific issues that are raised because that might create too much of a firestorm. You know, there's all these firestorm issues you see in the world where men are getting beat down severely. Things are being distorted and twisted and making men that do speak up look like pariahs, look like, super evil, ignorant, bigoted, ignorant people, you know, when they're not, actually. It's been taken out of context. It's been twisted and distorted to make the men look like they're terrible. And they never get to tell their side of it. You see, they never get to tell their side of it. It's a collective lynching. It's a lynch mob mentality we have now, if anyone dares speak up about it. Because why? We want to succeed at failure. We feel now's our opportunity to prove we do not choose our experiencing, to prove it by having something so terrible, it proves it. Here's the evidence. We're going to manufacture this evidence, say it proves that we're not free, therefore that proves that our will is greater than God's. Therefore, we are prime creator. Therefore, now we decree golden age, happiness forever and ever. That is what is taking place on this planet here. Count on it. Bank on it. And the way you can see this is to insist the only problem you have is a continuity problem. Insist upon it. Insist upon it. This is how I got myself to the vision of oneness. Insist upon it. I don't have a queen bee problem. I have a continuity problem. Period. I have absolutely no queen bee problem. The queen bee problem has absolutely no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. Insist upon it. That is your protection. That is your protection. That's why I'm able to talk like this. Because I feel I have that protection. Otherwise, there's no way I could say this, what I'm saying here. The panic attack would hit me after I post this on YouTube. The panic would be so severe, I'd commit suicide, essentially. Because you'd feel you're going to be completely ostracized from all, from entire humanity forever. 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 And no woman would ever speak to you again, ever, ever, ever. And no man would either, because they'd be under orders not to. You see what I'm saying? It's that type of ostracism. Total ostracism if you blow the whistle on this. This is a different kind of whistleblowing. You know, Snowden's a hero, right? But when you blow the whistle on this, nobody is going to take your side on this. Almost nobody. Almost nobody. A few might. There might be a few out there that would say, yeah, this is truth. But just like Jesus said to Peter, you're going to deny me three times before the cock crows in the morning, right? You will deny me. Guaranteed. If you blow the whistle on the world will deny you. Deny you, knowing you. Say, no. No, I'm not with them. I'm not with them. So you end up, you feel like you'll be completely abandoned if you bring this information up. Completely abandoned. But I know I don't have an abandonment problem. I have a continuity problem. Insist on it. I do not have an abandonment problem. I have a continuity problem. The abandonment problem has zero value to me. No value. Only the vision of oneness has value. That's how you stand up to self-deceit. The deceit that is egoic deceit. Our deceit, trying to deceive ourselves so we can become prime creator. That's how you stand up to it. Okay. Very great. Thanks for watching. Do not panic. Do not fear. Practice the continuity problem. I do not have an abandonment problem. I have a continuity problem. The abandonment problem has zero value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. This is how you do it. But my only problem is the continuity problem. I have no other problems whatsoever. I don't have an ostracism problem. I have a continuity problem. You see? This is how you can stand up and how you can literally have the vision of oneness and literally experience true happiness, and be freed from this ghastly effort to succeed at failure, to be freed from it forever. All right, very, very great. Okay, that's it for this video.